welcome to worship today at Second Baptist Church. We are so delighted to be here with all these faces and all these people. I know we have visitors out here today. Thank you so much for coming to Second Baptist Church. It's just an honor that you came to our church today and gave us the chance to get to know y'all. There is a QR code on the back of your bulletin if you'd like to scan it just to let us know a little bit about you, just so we can get to know you more, so we can say hello back. But thanks for coming today. And those of you joining us online, welcome too. We're so glad you took some time out of your weekend to be with us today. Today, I'm wearing my backpack because it is one of my favorite Sundays of the year. It is our backpack blessing day. School is about to kick off, and we have all these students in here and educators, and we will welcome them to the front during our children's time today and just bless them and bless our new school year so that everybody starts out in the right direction. So thank you for coming to church today. Also, today is Communion Sunday, and this morning, you will come forward, and you'll exit from the center of your aisle, and you'll come up to the front, and the deacons will serve you up here. And if you need the gluten-free option, it's in the tray, and it looks like this. It's already put together for you. And after you take communion, you will dispose of your cups in the bowls on the sides of the aisles, and then you'll return to your seats today. Y'all came on a great day because we are in a treat. We are in for a treat. We have guest artist today, David Gashin. Where are you, David? There you are, over here. Yeah, say hello. We're so honored to have him today. Most of you already know this, but let me remind you that David is a Texas Tech grad, and we're so proud of that. Reckham, yes. And he graduated from Texas Tech with vocal performance as his degree, and then moved, barely. We let you get through. That's good. And he moved to Chicago to start his career and became starring in a role as the Phantom. And then at the age of 26, did I get that right, David?
Yes, 3 years ago.
Yes, yeah, just a few years ago. Started out in the Phantom of the Opera and has performed that more than, get this, 1,300 times. We have an expert in the audience today, and we are so honored to have you here this morning. I'm thrilled that you're here with us, and we're looking forward to this worship service today. Welcome. Now, I would like to introduce to you also our newest members of Second Baptist Church, Mike and Dana Watkins. Where'd you go? You went to say, oh, stand up, do your thing, say hello. We're so glad you're here this morning. Welcome. We're looking forward to getting to know y'all. I know you've already plugged into a small group, so thank you for being part of our worship service this morning. One more thing. Please do not forget, y'all, we are looking for a new pastor of worship, and we need your input. And the survey is open for just a little bit more time. You can find the QR code on your second helping, but also the link is on our website. Please go on and fill out that survey so we know what it is you're looking for, what's important to you when it comes to worship at this church. Take your time to fill that out today because it's going to be closing soon, so we'll be excited to get your input. Gosh, there's so much going on, so many people. I'm so happy to see you all. Let's just take a moment. Let's take a breath and prepare ourselves for our worship service today. The Lord be with you.
Thank you. me for today's call to worship. We cry out, restore us, O God. We petition, God, may your face shine upon us. We lift our voices. We turn toward you, O God, and call on your name. Amen.
Shall bow, every tongue will confess that Christ is Lord. Every knee bows, every tongue confesses that you, O God, are good. And we join together now with all the knees and all the tongues, bowing in honor, confessing with joy that the Holy Spirit of God is here. Amen.
Hear the rolling thunder.
To invite all the boys and girls and youths and adults to come forward for our backpack blessing. Y'all come on up here. Anyone who would like to participate is welcome, whether you have your backpack or not. Come on up here. You can join us. We'd love you. You can participate. We'd love you. We're going to stand up. You guys want to stand? We can stand on the stairs. We can stand on the right here on the platform. Let's stand so everybody sees how awesome you guys look. Come on up here. Gather around. To see you. This is so exciting. Thank you all for coming this morning. Gosh, y'all, the start of a new school year. Oh, Lainey, you good? You okay, sweetest girl? Yeah, she says, yeah, she's tough. Come on up there. There we go. Well, come on up. Yep. All right. Y'all, I'm so excited that you're here because we are starting on a brand new school year. And it's always very exciting. And it's a little bit intimidating, right? As we approach this new, some of you are stepping into new schools. Some of you are stepping into whole new buildings and new places. Some of you went from high school to college. This is big, right? Some of you went from preschool to kindergarten and kindergarten on up. And gosh, this is just exciting. You're going to have new teachers and new friends. And we want you all to know that this church loves you. This church supports you. This church prays for you every single day. And as you go into this new school year, know that you have anyone in here that you could reach out to and talk to, and just know that we're praying for you and we love you. And we're going to bless you today. And as you leave, we'll pass out some tags if you'd like to take one. Just to remember that when you see that backpack blessing tag, that second B is thinking of you, and there's someone always praying for you. Church, if you would join us in our litany and our prayer today for all of these adults and students out here, we will read together the bold and I will read the non-bold if you'll join me this morning. Gracious God, we lift to you today our students and the educators dedicated to each of them. They stand here ready to receive your blessings, and they commit themselves to learning in the school year ahead. We ask your blessing on each of them. Further, we ask for your blessing on these backpacks. They will hold the schoolwork of each student and will be carried from home to school and back again. As these individuals carry these backpacks, may they be reminded of the love and care of this congregation that surrounds them each school day. We pray as well for the teachers and administrators in our schools. May they also be sustained by your grace. May they be reminded that this congregation embraces their call to education and surrounds them with love and care. I pray you all have the best school year ever. Let's pass out these tags. And after you get your tags, you can walk back to your seats. Or if you're going to I'm going to step down here, Declan. You can walk back to your seats or come with me to preschool praise. Would you help me pass out? And Mark, would you mind passing out some of these tags?
Today's epistle reading comes from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us. Looking to Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of faith, who for the sake of joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Please join me in prayer. We join together with your Spirit, O God, and pray for the world that you have created and the world that you love. We worship you in faith and in hope, knowing that all things rest in your hands. And we do pray yet again for these children, for educators, for janitors, for principals, for our city. We pray for families as they partner with the resurrection work of education. Lord, we do pray for these young ones and also pray for those who struggle to remember what it was like to go to school so many years ago, for those who live with memory loss, for those who are lonely, for those who desire to learn again but struggle to see. We pray for your healing. We pray for your comfort. We pray for your strength. And we pray for your rest. And we pray that all of these things would be generously shared with your people that you love, and that all of this would bring glory and honor to your name. It is in the name of the Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit by which we pray together. Amen. I invite you to stand.
Story.
The Old Testament reading today comes from Isaiah chapter 5, verses 1-7. I will sing for my beloved my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded rotten grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judea, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield rotten grapes? And now I will tell you that I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a wasteland. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they will not rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his cherished garden. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed, righteousness, but heard a cry. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, I don't want to preach after that. Thank you, David, so much. What a gift. A gift of Christ, and you've shared it with the body of Christ for the edification of Christ's people. If you're a guest and you're here with us, even if you plan to never, ever come back to this wild church, I really want to invite you to use the prayer cards that are available in front of you. One of our greatest honors and privileges as a staff as we gather around these requests for prayer, and we'd be honored to follow up with you with prayer or whatever way would be most helpful. I want to thank you, church, for your gifts to our church. Last week, we had a fabulous trip down to Piedras Negras, Mexico. It was 72 degrees there all week. And I want to just quickly show you, this is Pastor Israel Rodriguez, pastor 37 years there at First Baptist Church. And there's some of our team, and we're grateful for our team went down, and we're joined by some friends from a sister church as well. And there's Larry, and Larry really, our pianist, he really coordinated this whole trip. So if you would just join with me in appreciating him. And somehow, when we were down in Mexico, he dug up dirt on David Gashin and then, like, leveraged him to come be here. Is that how it happened? We were at a... Okay. Yeah. And finally, there's the finished kitchen. So, again, thank you so much, Larry. And I want to thank you, church, for giving to this relationship. The beds that we built 3 years ago are being used by families this very moment who are transitioning. And a beautiful Honduran family we got to have some tamales with. I've never met a tamale I didn't like, but I did find some that I liked last week. So thank you again. Our text in Isaiah today is a rich story. It might initially come off as a difficult pericope. And I believe that there's actually a key translation that sort of holds sort of a way in which this entire parable can be seen in a new way. It's a parable, of course, about a vineyard. Can a Baptist brother get an amen? And this is, of course, a metaphor that Jesus picks up on. The vineyard, near, particularly in the ancient world, but even now, to the space of a garden, where it all began there in Genesis 2 in our second creation story, as well as in John. You might remember that Jesus is laid in a garden tomb, raised. And Mary thought he was the gardener there at the resurrection. This is a resurrection parable that Isaiah is telling here in Isaiah 5. And there's a key translation that I'd like to point out to you. There's a word used twice. In verse 2 and in verse 4, that's not used anywhere else in the Hebrew Bible. And we've received through Angela's wonderful voice here as the body of Christ interpreting Scripture together, living the living word of Scripture you are, we've received this word as rotten grapes, that the vineyard owner had tried to build a vineyard, and instead of grapes thriving on the vine, it was these rotten grapes, as we received the translation. Other translation we'll call it bad fruit. And the word here, Boeotian, again, only used in this particular section in all of our Scripture. As is often the case, Hebrew words have a much wider meaning, particularly because this word is not used anywhere else. There's strong debate as to how to translate this word. And yet I'm captivated by maybe what we've received today, harder translation, rotten fruit or bad fruit. This word also contains within it just the wild sense of the plant, meaning in other translations will say the vineyard owner planted a vineyard, and yet instead wild grapes took over the vineyard, which reminds me of Second Baptist Church in Lubbock, Texas. A vineyard owner planted a vineyard and wild grapes took over. You, my brothers and my sisters, my friends, my brothers from other mothers, my sisters from other misters, you are wild grapes. You are. And I think this is just a fabulous note for us on a number of levels. But here's maybe one area in which I feel like I'm connecting with the story in a deep sense, is that the vineyard owner, a master gardener of sorts, puts all this work and all this planning into this garden. And yet, despite all of this expertise, despite all of this hard work, despite all of these planning and all of these lines where the grapes are supposed to thrive, despite all of that, wild grapes take over. And I'm feeling that. Despite any hard work, despite any expertise, despite, it feels as though maybe, and I imagine maybe you've been in that place, where there is an inverse proportion to the result compared to the amount of work that you put in. Yeah. You set up the business just right. Great business plan. Great strategy. Great market thing. You want me to help you with your business, by the way? Yeah. Everything was right. And the results didn't turn out. Or maybe it has nothing to do with work. Maybe it has, you've put all this energy, all this effort, all this love, all this care into a relationship, into a family member, into a friend. And even though you have given yourself to a healthy, to the well-being of this relationship, and you don't make it any traction. Yeah. There are seasons, despite all of our expertise, there are seasons, despite all of our effort, that there is not a direct relationship to our expertise and the results. You give yourself to this whole thing, and yet here we are, wild grapes are growing. And I think this is a rich metaphor. I'd like to show you one of the most spiritual images in my life right now. This is our garden. Won't you be my neighbor? Squash and zucchini there in the back, don't they look great? Our tomato. And this bell pepper plant, which has weathered the storm of this year's drought, has produced one bell pepper all year, and it was this big. And it was delicious. And the only reason why the rosemary, anyways, this is our garden. This is also what our backyard looks like. We're growing some great dirt this year. And most days, when I get home from visiting folks in the hospital, and most days you pull up to our house and our kids are causing terror. And I ask the girls, hey, you want to go water the garden? And we go out and we fill up these little buckets that the city of Lubbock gave us in this rain barrel program. And we fill up our little, and we go out into the alley, which is also owned by the city of Lubbock, I understand. And I try to put my water on the plants, you know. The girls just put water anywhere, you know. And Lainey, our two-year-old, she comes over here to this tomato plant and she goes, "You can do it." She's like, she comes over here to the bell pepper, she's like, "Go, go, 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 go." I think this is an incredibly rich metaphor for us. Yeah. The master gardener planned for a vineyard to prepare for his bride the best vintage, and wild grapes took over. This is part of this is resurrection. An aspect of resurrection is reversal. Throughout our scripture, there is this reversal. Younger sons and younger daughters, reversal. It is in our weakness that we are made strong. I've never had more fun gardening than I have had this year with these kids cheering on these awful, awful plants. I'd like to leave you with a story that's encouraging to my soul. a story about Bart Campolo. Tony Campolo, certainly a wonderful Baptist, an inspiration for many of us. Bart is now the chaplain at USC, and he was a youth leader growing up in Philadelphia and worked with some kids in the inner city of Philadelphia. And Tony told this story on his son, Bart. It said, what a novel idea they had. They had this idea that they would all get on vehicles and go outside of town and have a retreat weekend. Doesn't that sound nice? I say, let's do that together in February. You're all coming. All right, good. And so this inner city ministry decided they were going to have a spiritual retreat out in the Pocono Mountains, sort of like northwest Pennsylvania, a real beautiful area. And they loaded up two buses with teenage boys, which is one definition of hell for some of us. But and they take off, except for Bart leading the trip. He came behind the buses in a van, in a church van, which, and you know, a church van is a metaphor for a real vehicle, except it's really not very nice. And so they loaded up in this church van, and they're headed to the retreat center there in the Poconos, going west there on the Pennsylvania Turnpike. And sure enough, as church vans always do, they had a flat tire. And, you know, when you go anywhere with a bunch of boys, it's like baseball bats, 9 million miles of cables. Why do they need all these cords every time they go somewhere? I don't know. You know, and they have all this stuff in the van. So Bart says, guys, we gotta unload all this stuff. We gotta get to the spare tire. And so they unload all the stuff and get back there in the back ride, passenger side, rear tire. Bart, sure enough, gets this old, rusty, jankety jack and starts to jack up the car. And he's kind of using this as a teaching moment. You know, come on, guys, try to change the tire. So sure enough, jacks up the car, takes off the tire, and the jack gives out. And the car falls to the side. And Tony, the dad of the son, Bart, the ministry leader of the retreat, Tony said that at this moment his son said very religious language that was not very theological. And hundreds of kids already at the retreat center waiting on him. And the boys, the teenage inner city boys, say, hey, Bart, we'll lift it up for you. You know, so they all gathered around their van, picked it up, and Bart put the tire back on, took off to the retreat center, had a great weekend. On the way back, on the way home, a kiddo, teenager sitting in the front seat, looked to Bart and said, I became a Christian this weekend. And Bart looked at him and said, thanks be to God. That's amazing. He said, you know, if you don't mind me asking, what was it that inspired for you to receive the grace of God unending? Was it the sermons? Like, that friend of mine came in, he preached some great sermons, man. Was it the Bible study? Bart said, I wrote those Bible studies. They're pretty good. You know? Was it the worship? Man, what a beautiful, inspiring time of worship. And was it the fellowship? Was it just being encouraged by being surrounded by brothers in Christ all weekend? And the young man responded, he said, no, all that was boring. As retreats often are. All that was pretty boring. He said, you know what? I decided. He said, do you remember on our way here, we had a flat tire? And Mark said, yeah. He said, do you remember on the way here we had a flat tire and you were lifting into the van and took off the tire, and you remember the van fell over? And Bart said to the kid, yeah, I remember. He said, do you remember when we were on the way here and we had a flat tire and we lifted into the van and took off the tire and the van fell over? Remember when the van fell over? Remember you said all those words that my parents and my teachers tell me not to say? And Bart said, yes. And the young man said to Bart, he said, Mr. Campolo, I know you to be a man of faith, a man of kindness, a man of generosity. He said to Mr. Campolo, he says, you're a Jesus man. And if you could mess up in front of all those people, if you could mess up and let it slip and say religious language that's not very theological, then I thought, then I want to be a man of faith. I want to be a man of integrity. I want to be a man of generosity. I want to be a Jesus man like you're a Jesus man. It's not our perfection. It's not how good we plan the vineyard. It's not our expertise and all the things we think we know. It seems to me that the light of Christ shines best right through our brokenness, right through all those parts of you that you know to be imperfect. These are some of the best parts of you. The light of Christ shines best when we let it slip in front of a bunch of teenagers. The light of Christ, it shines best when that's the best thing we can grow. The light of Christ shines best when wild grapes thrive. That's the best vintage you can ever get. Let's pray together. We are broken. We are forgetful. We are selfish. We are grateful. We are your beloved children. And it is through us, all of us, that your unending light and glory shine. I ask, O God, personally, that you would bless these wild grapes and that your world, your vineyard, would be blessed by their flourishing. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. I invite you to stand as we continue to worship. If we can be of help to you now or at your convenience, we'd be honored to do so.
Join me in prayer, please. Our Creator, our Father, our Sustainer, how great thou art indeed. In this messy world filled with beginnings and endings, with celebrations and tribulations, we have gathered this morning in your holy presence. Your voice has called us together. And in this sanctuary, we are reminded that we have experienced your grace and your love, your forgiveness, your many blessings. And now as we begin to think about what lies ahead this next week, may we go out to share your light, to share your forgiveness, to share your grace, to share your blessings in a world of beginnings and endings. Be with us. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
And pass the peace of Christ with one another.
With me now as we were all taught to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. We come now to the table here at Second Baptist Church, and one of the most beautiful parts of Second B is that everybody is welcome and invited to come to the table. We're not going to check your ID. We just want you to come and share in this meal with each of us this morning. And we remember back to that night when Jesus gathered his disciples in this room. And I can imagine that it was a dark and small and dusty room, and they were probably nervous and scared and didn't know what was coming. And I just love knowing that the presence of Jesus was right there with them to calm them and to ease their fears and their nerves, which is what Jesus does for all of us. And right before them, he picked up the bread and he broke it in front of them. And he said, "This is my body. I want you to take it and I want you to eat it. And every time you do, remember me and remember how much I love you." And in the same way, he took the wine, and as he was pouring, he said, "This is my blood. It's a whole new covenant I'm creating with you and everyone that is to come. Share my love with those. And every time you drink it, remember me." And now I invite you all, as the deacons come forward, to come to the table this morning.
We still can see. Thank you. can see.
Thank you, church, for being here. You are the primary way that I know and I believe Christ is risen. David, thanks for being here and helping Larry sound good for one. I mean, thank you for being here. Amen. Thank you to our deacons serving communion and reminding us of the servant of Christ, the Savior of the world. I'd like to just pause just real quick, and if you would join me, last Sunday when I was away was the completion of 4 years of pastoral ministry for Pastor Cheryl Gallerno here in our congregation. Cheryl, if you'd stand, let us appreciate you. Amen. We pray that God bless you and your family as you have blessed us and this family. If you would stand and receive this benediction. May all your jacks fail and all your tomato bushes burn to the ground. You wild grapes are one of the primary ways that God will bless this world. Go in peace.